Hi everyone, this is GKCS. In this video, we'll be talking about some of the less useful tech advice that is shared amongst all of us engineers, especially for startups and mid-sized companies. If you're working in a large organization, most of this advice will not be useful to you. So you can watch this as an entertainment piece or as something that you could possibly find useful when you join a company. At the end of this video, you should have a set of red flags which go up if someone mentions one of these jargon pieces to you when you're working in a small organization. And this video will really be successful if by the end of it, you have a general red flag which goes up whenever a person talks about things that you don't really understand, are in hype, and seem to be useful possibly someday in the future. So let's start with some pretty bad tech advice. Number 5, containers. Containers fall perfectly in the category of it could be useful sometimes, but it's probably not going to be useful to me. The reason I say this is because containers have amazing facilities when it comes to auto scaling, when it comes to complex deployments, when it comes to scheduling deployments, when it comes to managing a cluster, none of which are usually relevant for a startup or a mid-sized company. The only place where I have found containers to be actually useful is when you have a team of, let's say, 5 or more developers who are locally testing code. And for them to deploy it locally becomes a bit of a hassle. So you having a container which you can share with them and they can deploy on the local machine and test helps. So all the best practices for containers may not be relevant for your startup. In fact, I would say it's highly unlikely to be relevant for your startup, and it is unlikely to be relevant even for a mid-sized company. The drawback here is that containers usually add a little bit of complexity to your architecture. They also add some latency, a little bit, to your architecture. They take up a little more space. None of this is really going to affect you as a small company because your tech costs should ideally be really low. So adding a layer of containers really is not going to explode your costs because the costs are manageable, but it is needless. So in the range of useless to terrible, I would put containers somewhere around useless. Number 4, NoSQL. NoSQL databases are far better than SQL databases. But the caveat here is that SQL databases are far better than NoSQL databases. You see, it depends on what the use case is. But I'll give you some good news. It doesn't matter if you have a startup or if you have a mid-sized company. It does not matter what kind of database you use. Yeah, you might feel like, oh my God, what do you mean it doesn't matter what database I use? What if it's a tech startup? Yeah, yes. In certain exceptional cases, it makes sense to truly understand how the database is running. In most cases where you're providing customer value, they don't care how you're storing your data. When you go to Google Maps, you don't think that, oh wow, there must be a graph database. And if they're not using a graph database, you don't get irritated. You're just focused on the latency of you getting a route. Now, what would be a use case for NoSQL? Scale? Easy schema change? No joins? Yeah, all of this are totally irrelevant for you as a startup. Scale for a startup, firstly, I mean, what are you talking about? You have 10,000 users. Go get some users and then we'll talk about scale. But the other two problems of schema change. What do you mean schema change? Just fire a alter table query 10 times, 20 times. If you have a very large table, then what you can do is fire an alter table query at 2 a.m. in the night. You take a table lock, make the schema changes, it doesn't matter. And joins, you can cache some of the popular queries that you have in a startup or mid-sized company. If you cannot cache it for God knows what reason, you want extremely consistent data, denormalize your tables in SQL and you are as good as NoSQL. The only use case that I have seen of NoSQL in startups is because the tech team, the developers are comfortable with NoSQL instead of SQL. So they go ahead and use NoSQL, in which case it's okay. I mean, I don't want you to learn about SQL right now. If you're very comfortable with a certain database, go ahead. Like I said, the data store doesn't really matter. So in the scale of useless to terrible, I would say NoSQL is later on a bit painful because you end up doing things which you don't really need. So we can give it a rating of mildly infuriating. Number 3, microservices. Microservices have been under a lot of scrutiny recently. The benefits of microservices, which are continuous deployment, isolation of concerns, pinpoint scalability, parallel development, don't really affect you in a small organization. You can do this by yourself anyway. And if you have a team of 15, like 15 is a pretty large team, how do you manage that? you can have a modular monolith, right? Which is like a microservice of one service. it's a monolith where all the code is placed in one repository. If multiple people are working on different pieces of code, as long as they don't touch each other's code, you're fine. Your team is fine. Unlike containers, microservices can actually harm your organization, even for a small company where the development speed goes down because you have a bunch of microservices sometimes written in different languages with their own different flavors. If a dev leaves your organization, you don't really have the standard setup so that when a new dev comes in, they are able to understand the overall architecture and the microservices that you have in your company. So it's best to just have one place, one monolith, which is hosting all of your code and keep the context wrapped up in one place. Giving a rating to microservices, I would say it's something like hurtful. It's bad, it's not horrible, but it is bad. Number two, quality obsession. If you have a mid-sized company, I'm talking about 10,000 to 1 lakh users, having stringent code reviews, trying to standardize the way in which you write code and testing large pieces of code may not be able to give you the bang for buck that you're looking at. Developers will end up spending most of their time working on existing features, eradicating bugs which would never have come up, instead of focusing on customer requirements and building capabilities that the startup actually needs. If you're working in a startup where most of the work is around reviews, documentation, extensibility, and test cases, run. I'm being frank with you because, you know, if this is what they're focusing on, what else? What comes after this? Do they have any plan? Ask them. You know, do you have any features coming up? Do you have any products coming up? Because if we are just going to be focusing on this when users don't exist, it means that the money is drying up. The only time I would focus on code quality in a startup is if it is an important piece of code, like if it's a core system that you have and you know that it's going to last for at least 6 months. Yeah, writing test cases makes a lot of sense there. But unless most of the cows are walking through that piece of code, just ignore it. Use it like a graveyard. No one goes there. We don't care. Our code quality is fine. When you're doing code reviews, you focus on three things only. One is correctness, second is readability, and the third is extensibility. Do not focus on things like, oh, these are the best practices, or this would be the perfect design pattern to implement here. No one cares about your design pattern when you have like 10,000 users, right? Because what you need to do is you need to ship the code and see whether users are finding it useful. If they find it useful and you have 1 lakh users or 10 lakh users tomorrow, that's when you can focus on your code quality. So giving it a rating of how bad it is, I would say it's more than hurtful. It's actually painful to your team because it feels so innocent. I'm just trying to improve the code quality. But in reality, what's happening is your features are getting slowed down and you're looking more in terms of art than implementation. Number one, automation. This can kill startups. This often kills startups. And unfortunately, most of us engineers have an unhealthy affinity towards automating things which occur repetitively. The best example for this would be customer success, where you have a person who's talking to a customer. Now, the cost of losing a customer is very high. The benefits of providing a great service are very high. You could say that ChatGPT will take care of this for me, so let me just integrate an API. But ChatGPT is an idiot. It can't really talk to a customer and understand their true needs. It speaks well. It doesn't have a brain. So what ends up happening is you lose customers because you've automated most of your system. And of course you can scale. You can scale a bad product as much as you like. Your customers are not scaling, but your tech definitely is scaling. Parts of that process, like setting up an appointment, maybe that scheduler can be automated. So whenever you come across a use case where you can see automation as a possibility, I would suggest you go through this checklist. Is this going to continue? Long term, is my automation actually going to help the company? Two, adoption. The people you're creating the code for really need to love what you've built for them. That's the only time they'll actually use it. So if you automate a mailing engine and the marketing team doesn't like it, then your product is useless. No one is going to actually be working with that marketing engine. They'll still go back to the CEO and still ask them for, hey, can we use a off-the-shelf solution? Three, is it extensible? Tomorrow when the requirements change, and they will, do you see at least the most critical parts of that code being extensible? So if you're writing a mailing engine for existing customers, can it tomorrow send emails to a set of customers who are from a different platform? It's best to talk to the product team or the CEO in your company, in a mid-sized company. I mean, there's just 20, 30 people. So talk to them and ask them, do you see this happening in future? if it is, make sure your code is a little extensible. 4, cost. What is the cost of you actually building this service? If you are going to take half a month, that means it will take you roughly 1 week to test the system comfortably. And then you'll also have to maintain it. So what is the cost? How much time investment are you doing? Could you be working on something else? And 5, which is the most important, time saved. Long term, which is 6 months, right? Or at most a year. How much time do you think will be saved by doing this piece of automation? If it takes you 3 hours every day to do this and automating it will convert it into 1 hour every day, that is amazing. That automation is necessary for the company. But if it takes you 1 day a month to do something and it'll take you half a month to automate it, it doesn't make sense for a startup or a mid-sized company. So in a scale of useless to terrible, I would say this is absolutely terrible if done wrong. Automation, just to clarify, can be very, very useful to your company when done right. But when done wrong, it saps the blood out of your company, makes development much slower and complex, and loses customers. So that's it for this video. I hope now you have a set of red flags inbuilt, which tell you that this tech may not be necessary and therefore we are not going to adopt it until we find a good reason for it. You can explore the tech, but you don't need to adopt it before you're sure. Of course, all of these opinions are a bit controversial and I may be wrong in quite a few of them. So let's have this discussion in the comments below. Let me know your thoughts. Let me know your suggestions. Let me know your viewpoints. If you like these kind of videos, hit the like button. And if you want notifications for further videos like this, hit the subscribe button. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.